Hello and welcome to the Empathic Designer Podcast. I am your host, Vaidheeswaran. So we are back with another episode from our conversation series, and we have our first returning guest on the channel, Mr. Arun Subramanian, the Managing Director of Top League Training and Business Consulting. Mr. Arun is an international success coach and a renowned expert on cognitive behavioral sciences, and I believe that we have the perfect guest for this evening to discuss a very important and interesting topic, which is especially relevant for today's era, which is the role of implicit learning in the training industry. So we are recording today's episode with a wonderful live audience. I would therefore request the audience members to stay on mute and help everyone enjoy our conversation. If you have any questions, please post them on the chat window and we'll do our best to accommodate them in today's program. So once again, a very warm welcome to Mr. Arun Subramanian. It's wonderful to have you back on our channel, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Vaidheeswaran. Thanks a lot.
Thank you.
I'm all yours.
Absolutely. So let's start with the fundamentals. So could you please help us understand what exactly is implicit learning?
It's funny that you should be asking this question, because we are all here only because of implicit learning. Mm-hmm. From the very second that we were born, we have been learning in an implicit manner only. So implicit learning, or what is also known as tacit learning. Is my voice audible? Is it clear?
Yes, your voice is audible.
Whenever you learn something without being consciously aware of learning, it is implicit learning. Let me explain it to you a few examples. So you do know how to drive a car, isn't it?
Yes.
How do you think it has happened? Did you consciously focus on it? You drove it a number of times. Every time you struggled a bit less. And a time came when you just knew how to drive a car. And very frankly speaking, Mr. Vaidheeswaran, you will not be able consciously to drive a car.
Yeah,
that is a classic example of implicit learning. Second thing, you do go to office every day, isn't it, Mr. Vaidheeswaran?
At least I come to my work desk now. Yes.
Okay, now, okay, but otherwise in your, you know, maybe about 15, 20 years of career, you have been going to the office every day.
Yes, I have.
And you have been negotiating the complexities of office life.
Yes.
You know, office politics is very, very common. Now, how do you learn to navigate the office life? That is something called, you know, dynamic social control. Mm-hmm. How did you do system control? How did you do it? Did you focus that I would interact with this person in this way under these circumstances? Is there any standard operating procedure which you followed to learn how to do it?
No.
That is implicit learning.
Right.
Okay. So we are discussing with each other. Mm-hmm. So what is it we are doing? We are communicating.
Yes.
Isn't it?
Yes.
So where did you learn the syntax of all the grammar? Before you, you know, people think they learned grammar in the grammar class. But did you? The thousands of people who are talking, so many languages. How many languages do you speak, Mr. Vaidheeswaran?
I speak 5 languages, sir.
5. Okay. So how many languages did you attend the grammar class?
Probably 3.
And what about the other 2 then? Is it all gibberish that you are talking, or are you making sense?
I guess I'm making sense. People are able to understand.
That is implicit learning. Yeah. You know, there are tests being conducted today on what is called artificial grammar learning to find out how this implicit learning is happening. Implicit learning is the process by which you learn things without knowing. And this is a very, very important science. And it's a very controversial science. People have not yet been able to arrive at what the definition of implicit learning really is. Mm-hmm. You know, lots of studies are going on. In fact, you know, in one study, they took amnesiac. They put him in front of a maze. I don't remember, it was some maze in England. And, you know, every day they took him there. He thought he was coming there for the first time. From there, you know, he was asked to go to the center of the maze. Every day he used to take a different route. But they found over a period of time that he was reaching the center faster than the first time, even though he had no memory of ever having come there. In other words, implicit learning, that which you have learned implicitly, cannot be erased even by the most, you know, really bad neurological disorders like Alzheimer's. It all stays intact. Implicit learning is something which is there permanently with you.
Great. So I think that was a very comprehensive
Another thing, you know, implicit learning, if you really want to know how it happens, see, from the moment you're born, implicit learning is happening. Mm-hmm. What people very popularly call observational learning. You learn by observing things.
Yes.
Because everyone comes only with genetic memory and nothing else. But then how do they learn? And you know, within the first 3 years, nearly 80% of everything that you have to learn in your life, you have already learned. How did you do that? Who took classes for you? Where are the standard operating procedures of how you should address life? All that is happening only by implicit learning. And it is very essential for a trainer to know how to, you know, drive his training through implicit learning, because that is the only way you can teach a person. You see, the moment the conscious mind comes into play, you know, we need to understand that the reptilian brain is over 350 million years old, the most powerful. That's what life came on to land from water with. It has got only three functions to govern. It ensures that you are kept alive. It ensures that you procreate and the species moves forward. And for both these things to do, food is necessary. It ensures that you get food. Then as the cognitive load kept on increasing, it assigned a portion of its functions to the limbic system. And the limbic system was formed about 150 million years back. The formation started. Once that matured, then started the cerebral cortex, which is the neocortex, which is only about 2 million years old.
Right.
So you see, our dependence on the conscious mind is in fact an illusion. It cannot do anything. It is only a postman. It collects information, passes it on to the reptilian brain to decide what exactly it should do. So if you are interested in driving your training, implicit learning is a must. In fact, you know, the very concept of meta-learning, learning to learn itself, is an implicit learning function.
Yes, absolutely. So, I mean, it's very interesting that you brought this concept of the evolution of brain, and that actually brings me to my next question. So, I attended the HETS International seminar yesterday, and I did listen to you speak over there. And it was very interesting to see how you talked about the evolution of the cognitive levels from the Bloom's taxonomy. So could you help our viewers to understand the evolution of cognitive levels from Bloom's taxonomy?
You see, in late 1940s, that is in 1949, a committee was formed to scientifically organize education. The head of that committee was Benjamin Bloom. Mm-hmm. 1949 to 1953, that committee deliberated on how education should be driven. And in 1953, they came to a conclusion. They put on paper a protocol. And I think it was in 1957 that Bloom's taxonomy was propounded. Since he was the head of the committee, the taxonomy was in his name. And it is, you know, it has six levels. Mm-hmm. It starts with remembering. The primary thing is that whatever is being taught, the student should be able to remember what has been taught. You know, you and I think all the people who are there in this platform now, they had a teacher standing at the head of the class and lecturing to them. And at the end of the year, they were tested on how much they remembered it. That is how education was driven. It's in fact still driven in most places. That means we have not transcended even the first level of the Bloom's taxonomy. It is all, you know, rote learning and vomiting at the right time. The more you are better, you are able to replicate what has been taught to you, the more marks you get, and the you keep rising up. The second level was understanding, where in Bloom's taxonomy, what you remember, you are tested to see whether you understand it or not. The third level is applying. This is where, you know, you start applying what you have. Then you come to analysis. You analyze what you have applied, what the results are, what are the gaps, and you do a gap analysis or whatever it is. Then you come to evaluate. You evaluate possibly the result. And then finally, you start creating. Now, if you see these six levels, you will find there is a massive disconnect between each of them in the education system. Mm-hmm. Please remember, this was done at a time when cognitive science had not evolved.
Right.
In 1990, functional magnetic resonance imaging came into play. Mm-hmm. And people started understanding cognition, how man thinks, what happens within the brain, all these things much better. They could peep into the brain in a non-invasive manner, and from multiple points in the brain, they could collect data and understand how the mind works.
Right.
They realized that if you require to educate people, you have to do much, much, much more than what the Bloom's taxonomy was addressing. Unfortunately, education still in many places is driven by Bloom's taxonomy, and people talk a lot about Bloom's taxonomy. No doubt, Bloom's taxonomy is a foundational principle on which the edifice of education is standing. But, you know, as they say, if you want to move forward, you have to leave the ground on which you are standing now. You can't carry the ground with you.
Yes.
When you take a foot forward, you will have to leave that ground on which you are currently standing behind. That was when, you know, in Marzano and Kendall in 2007 propounded the taxonomy of cognitive science, where they said that all knowledge is already present in you. It's only a question of retrieving it in a contextual manner.
Yes.
So you see, you retrieve the knowledge from inside you. You instruct your, you know, what do you call it, temporal, occipital, parietal lobes or whichever it is, to get the knowledge from the subconscious, from your memory, long-term, short-term. And then you do what? Comprehend it in the context in which you are retrieving it. Then you analyze it. How well it is fitting into the current context. What is this thing called? The information, the context, the analysis, and the fit is what is called knowledge. The fourth level is knowledge understanding. Once the knowledge understanding comes, now you navigate your mind, and now this is where, you know, cognitive science comes.
Yes.
It is called metacognition, the fifth, where you start thinking about how you are thinking.
Yes.
Everyone is aware of, you know, Edward de Bono's six hats, where he says you look at things from a different perspective. If you are not aware of which perspective you are looking through now, how will you be able to transit to the second perspective? This is what is metacognition, where you become aware that I am looking at it with greater optimism. Now I need to see what are the pitfalls in it. You move. So this is metacognition. Then you say that now I will look at this problem from the angle of only drawing on the data, information, and create insights. From there, you move on to see what can be done. This metacognition is thinking about how you are thinking. From all these things, a product comes out. Now you have reached the sixth stage of the taxonomy of cognitive science, which is self-system. Self-system is now you decide whether you want to move forward, continue with that same thinking, with that problem. Have you found the insight? Would you like to drop it and move on? What is your motivation to do it? All these things come at that stage. We were following in this way through taxonomy of cognitive science. When around this period, around the middle, in the early 2010, we had Richard Chandler, another cognitive scientist. He came up with a nudge theory. You all know that Richard Thaler has got the Nobel Prize in 2017 for behavioral economics. And he propounded a theory of libertarian paternalism. What is libertarian paternalism? Libertarianism is a theory propounded, which is enshrined in the US Constitution, that you cannot force a person to do something against his wish. The Constitution of the United States is such a strong document that, you know, liberty is enshrined in it. You know, even today, when we talk of US, the first thing which comes to our mind is the Statue of Liberty.
Right.
So the liberty is enshrined in the Constitution of the United States of America. And libertarianism was a principle, a founding principle of it. They said that you cannot force anyone to do anything that they don't want to do. But with Nuss theory, Richard Thaler introduced libertarian paternalism, where he said, you can nudge people in a particular direction in their interest without forcing them. That means what I think is good for you, if I'm thoroughly convinced and I'm convinced that I'm not infringing on your democratic rights, I can nudge you psychologically to move in that direction.
Right.
Libertarian paternalism, nudge theory, taxonomy of cognitive, you know, learning, combined together is the most powerful tool in the hands of a trainer, master trainer, to create transformation in the minds of people. I'll give you an example. You see, there are various things. There are various ways of doing it. There are many strategies of doing. Reality for one, as they say, sauce for the geese is not necessarily sauce for the gander. Okay. So you have, you know, reality distortion effects. You got reality wrapping. So many things are there. So many strategies are there. All these strategies are applied by a master trainer to create the seeding of a particular insight in your mind.
Right.
You know, we have often heard this statement, you can take horse to water, you can't make him drink it. What does it mean? If the person principally is not having the thirst for knowledge, he will never try to go for it. But if I were to create the thirst for knowledge in my student, then I can sit back. Today, you see, fortunately, everything is available for everyone in this world.
Right.
There is an explosion of information. But how you utilize it, how you gather it, all depends upon how much you are thirsty for that knowledge. It is the job of a teacher or a trainer to create that thirst in that individual to get the knowledge. Let us not forget, today the reference point of concentration of every individual is a goldfish.
Yes.
I know many people will feel bad that they are being compared with a goldfish, but I can tell you the goldfish in a slightly advantageous position, it doesn't know it is being compared. A goldfish has got a concentration span of only 9 seconds. If within the 9 seconds, you cannot hook that person, you're done. He will move on.
Absolutely, sir. I think you make a very pertinent point over here, because when we say that a person's attention is less than or almost equal to that of a goldfish, it's not really the fault of the person. It's just a showing of how we have evolved in terms of creating content and creating knowledge. That's all it really takes for someone to get knowledge, and they can get knowledge at that rate. So how, as a trainer, you are able to put in those hooks and make sure that your learner is kept to you, I think that's a very pertinent point that you're making, and I think that's a very strong message that you're sending out to the trainers today. So on that note, I would like to ask you if you can elaborate. I mean, you were talking about the 6 stages of cognitive learning. So could you help us understand how implicit learning is supported by these 6 stages?
Implicit learning is supported by these stages.
Yes.
Absolutely. You see, these stages are going to be driven by the trainer or the teacher.
Yes.
Right?
Yep.
like I was talking yesterday. See, there are many strategies, many, many strategies. Okay, before we come to that, you must be wondering how this implicit learning takes place. Implicit learning takes place because of situation and circumstances you find yourself in. Mm-hmm. And the stimulus, the external stimulus is what drives implicit learning. Okay? Mm-hmm. Now that, you know, today morning, I think Mr. Zafar Deen is there in this platform. I saw somewhere.
Okay.
Mr. Zafar Deen, are you there? Can you just check?
Yeah, he's there.
Mr. Zafar Deen, send me a video today morning. Mm-hmm. Mr. Zafar Deen, can you come on the audio? He did not send to me.
Okay.
He posted the video in the value proposition group. He had attended that program and then he had am I right, Mr. Zafar Deen? You had posted one video on the value proposition group today morning. We can't hear you, Mr. Zafar Deen. Now, I would like to show you people that video. Mm-hmm. And I want to know from you what you have understood. Okay, Mr. Zafar Deen, there is a lot of disturbance. You can mute. I will show you that video. I want you to tell me what exactly you have understood from this video. It's a 2-minute video. Do you have the permission to show it?
Yes, yes, please do.
Can you share the screen?
Yes, you can. You can.
You can. You can share your screen, sir.
Okay. Now, see, watch this video.
Taken. The performer is him.
I don't think the video is coming through. Could you please try replaying it?
Sorry, we are not considering the disabled for the auditions.
You're mistaken. The performer is him, my brother. I'm here just to cheer.
I'm not disabled. I'm differently abled.
Yes, I want to hear from you. What did you understand from this?
I think it was very nice video with a good message that, I mean, you're only limited by your own imagination.
Anyone else would like to answer? Yes, Mr. Chandrasekhar. Please unmute and answer.
Looks can be deceiving, sir.
This is a classic instance of driving implicit learning through the power of a methodology called reality wrapping. What did you see? Let's go back to the video and see what we saw. How the subconscious, you know, how the subconscious is unfolding the multiple messages, the multiple layers of messages which are there in it.
Okay.
In one single shot, you know, it does not register. But what is happening is you are being subjected to two actions called the Zeigarnik effect and the sleeper effect. When I saw this, I don't know whether Mr. Zafardeen realized how much has gone into preparing this video. I'll show you. I'll unfold it and show it to you.
Okay.
We have to share your screen again.
Yeah.
Yes.
Now, I'm going to remove the sound so that you will be able to hear what I'm saying.
Yeah.
Now see, the hand is on the elbow of the girl. Now you see, she is, you know, she's telling you are mistaken. She's not telling anything else. She is guiding him, but the impression is that she is the disabled.
Yes.
Now you see, he has come for an audition for which eyesight is not required. That is getting established. You will observe now that she is looking down. She is not looking at the stage, giving the feeling that she is disabled. He first moves towards the wall. So it's very obvious that he does not know in which direction he's facing. Now he's turning around. It is at this juncture that she starts moving to show that she is not the one who is disabled. Jumps up the stairs to the surprise of the people, the judges. When she goes and holds his hand, he reaches out and touches, showing that he is the one who is disabled. Here he proves it, and she puts the glasses on him. Now he says, I am not disabled. Now the audience also, the judges also come to his side. Now the final learning, promote opportunities, not disabilities. Which means that in every disability, that is something good to look for. How beautifully the learning has been hit. This is called implicit learning. And this is one of the most widely distributed videos on WhatsApp. Am I right, Mr. Zafardeen?
Yes, sir. I have received this video myself as well. You're right.
You see, this is what is called implicit learning. What is embedded in your mind is a small seed. It says, look at people at being differently abled, not disabled. You see, when you hold the position of a trainer or a teacher, We should always remember that we are a mentor. We are a farmer. Our job is to plow the mind of our students or participants and sow the seed that we want to sow. It is up to the student to water it, air it, sun it, and bring forth the potential which is hidden inside it. That is what the taxonomy of cognitive education, learning, and nudge theory works at. Right. There are multiple strategies by which you can drive implicit learning in your training classes. This is one, and on 25th, in my masterclass, I'm going to be showing you how to hold an audience for a period of 3 hours and drive implicit learning for just one insight. But that will be such a powerful insight that you will never forget it in your life.
Absolutely,
the time span is not important. The explosive energy within the insight is important.
Absolutely. So for people in the audience who are not aware of this, Mr. Arun Subramanian is going to give a masterclass on the 25th of this month at 11 in the morning. It's going to run for around 3 hours. So I'll be posting a link to that session in the description below. It's a free session. You can register and attend the session, and I'm sure it's going to be a fantastic session. So on that note, sir, you were talking towards the end of your explanation that about this concept of seeding. Could you please elaborate a little bit more on this process of seeding?
You see, seeding, you know, you have a particular idea which you want to convey to your audience. Okay. The human, the mind, you know, is an argumentative creature.
Yes.
You know what we call self-talk? What is self-talk? Self-talk is two people inside your head fighting it out eternally. They never meet. They are like two parallel lines of a railway track. They never meet. For everything one says, the other will counter it. So teaching and training has to be such that it has to bypass these two tracks and go down. If you are going to address the conscious mind, you will get trapped on these two lines. The moment you say something, the other will say, oh, I know all these things. Are you? Leave it. This doesn't work. So you have to bypass the conscious mind and embed that idea in the subconscious mind, where what it will do is, you see, the subconscious mind, how does it work? The subconscious mind, as soon as information goes in, it stores it in a totally different way. It does not store it alphabetically. It does not store it in association. It stores it in terms of likes. So when you put an idea in the subconscious, it will start looking at all the ideas it has got in its repositories, which are akin or related to it. And it will store it along with that. And then, you know, it will start budding. It will take the nutrition from all that and it will start growing. This is the process of seeding.
Right. Great. So I actually have another question for you. I think we have a number of trainers in our audience today who will also be curious to know the answer to this. So one of the common advices I hear trainers giving to others is to identify your niche area and stick with it from a training perspective. So do you think this is really the right approach for trainers?
I'll ask you a question. Instead of answering this question this way, I'll ask you another question.
Counter question. Yes, sir.
Yes. I'm entitled to ask the interviewer some question, isn't it?
Absolutely.
Okay. So tell me one thing. You are a South Indian?
Yes, I am.
You are a vegetarian?
Yes.
So I presume you have rasam, sambar, you know, vegetables, veggies,
yes,
rice, curd, cereals, ghee, roti, North Indian dish, everything you have, isn't it?
Yes, I do.
How would it look if I were to advise you to take only rice and nothing else?
I don't think I will really like that. And even from then a nutritional perspective, it's not going to really work.
Then why are you accepting this? I will tell you. Mm-hmm. There are two types of trainings.
Okay.
One is called a technical training. The other is called an aspirational training. I think we have here in this group one extremely accomplished gentleman called Mr. Narendra Nayak. He's a naval seaman.
Yes.
Mr. Nayak, are you there?
Yes, Mr. Nayak is here.
Okay. I can't hear you, Mr. Nayak. Unmute.
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Okay. Good. Nice having you on the screen.
Thank you, sir.
Now, Mr. Nayak is a seaman. So he's an expert in everything related to going to the sea, right?
Yes.
If he were to give a training to all those people who go to the sea for our naval people, that will be what? That will be a technical training.
Yes.
But why should he not give training for others? I will tell you how. There are so many people here. I have seen today on the screen Dr. Gumbadi from Andhra Pradesh, who was there in the program yesterday. I saw Dr. Kaur, who was also there in the program yesterday. They are all highly accomplished educationists.
Yes.
Right? Now, if I were to start teaching them on education, I'm the biggest fool on this earth. There could be a cardiothoracic surgeon here. There could be an highly accomplished Supreme Court lawyer here. There could be a CEO of a pharma company, a managing director of a pharma company. There could be so many highly accomplished people. Yes. I, as a trainer, cannot be an expert in all their subjects. Then how do I train them? So what is this thing called aspirational training? Aspirational training is where, supposing, let us say, I'm doing a program on value chain analysis. This is a program which is very required for business people, entrepreneurs. My job is not to do extensive research on value chain analysis, come and teach them how to do value chain analysis. My job is to embed in their mind the seed that value chain analysis is important for success in the company.
Absolutely.
If I do that, they will go. Each company is unique. Each person is unique. Each business is unique. They will go use their current expertise, understand contextually how value chain analysis has to be done in their company and bring it up. As I said, as a mentor holding the stage, my job is to create aspirations in the mind of the audience.
Yes.
Now there are so many educationists here. I'm not going to teach them how to teach. They can teach me how to teach. They have got so many years of experience. But if I can put a seed in their mind, keep moving forward, if you adopt cognitive teaching principles and the nudge theory, if you adopt principles of how to create an implicit learning atmosphere in your classroom, then you will be able to drive the desire in the student to learn. How have I done my job?
I think that is one of the most succinct explanations I've heard, differentiating between a subject matter expert, a trainer, a presenter, and a coach.
So now tell me, should you restrict yourself to a niche?
I don't think so.
That's all.
You are only limited by your imagination and what you want to do with yourself.
Correct.
Correct. You know, they call this the invisible fence that you have put across your mind, that yes, I cannot do anything else.
Yes.
Only you can break it. No one else can break it for you. As someone rightly said, think you can, think you can't. Either way, you will be right.
Yeah. absolutely. That was a wonderful point. So this actually brings me to my final question. So I'm going to circle back to one of the earlier responses you gave, where you linked, you were talking a bit about observational learning. So I would like to hear a little bit more on your thoughts on observational learning and how that leads into implicit learning.
You see, implicit learning is learning without being aware. Monkey see, monkey do is something which everyone knows.
Yes.
You see, his child learns to throw things. From where does it learn to throw things?
It just sees people throwing things and it does.
No, you see, that is observational learning. And then things break. Parents tell see and it sees it is broken. But please understand, before the age of nearly 7, it can't even associate things. You know, the ability to associate consequence with behavior comes somewhere around the age of 18 to 21. That is the reason why even in the Indian Penal Code, youngsters below the age of 18 are not held responsible for their behavior. They are sent to correction schools. They are not penalized or punished. So much so, we all remember that gruesome rape and murder case. What was that case?
The one from Delhi.
Delhi, yes.
Nirbhaya case.
Yes. One of the main accused was a minor. He had not yet touched 18. There was a huge hue and cry that he should not be let off. But he was. He went to a correction school. You see, everything that we learn is through observation. I don't know whether you're aware of this or not. You see, over 50% of the neocortex is involved in visual acuity.
Mm-hmm.
Everything that we learn through seeing. The mind is totally overwhelmed by sight. Only 7% of it goes to hearing. Second thing is, we all know from physics that light travels faster than sound. You see first, hear later. That gap can be a big disincentive for you. Many, many, many trainers forget that vision, the sight, you know, leads. And voice follows, hearing follows. Oftentimes they put the slide and then talk. By the time they start talking, the slide has become old news. The mind has disconnected.
I think what you're saying is even more relevant today, where your trainer is now occupying a 1 inch by 1.5 inch, and 95% of the screen is occupied by their PowerPoint slides. So I think what you're saying is even more pertinent in these difficult times.
You see, the Mehrabian myth, why was it propounded? The Mehrabian myth where it says, you know, the 7% is word, 38% is tonality, and 55% is, you know, what do you call it? The 55% is body language. Because when sitting in a room, you are seeing a person. If the person has got a gigantic personality, is emotive, his histrionic abilities are very good, he can talk rubbish and get away with it. Because 93% is consumed by all that rubbish, the body language and the tonality. What he talks doesn't register at all, maybe. But here, that is not the case. Here, you have to have content, you should be able to create it, because observation is reduced to a very large extent. So now you see strategies become important. As an answer to your question, on the offline, on the classroom, observation plays a very important role in implicit learning. But on the online, observation is brought down to bare minimum. Here, content, structure, transition, slicing, bite-sized messages, being able to seed and drive your message, these become king. Absolutely. If you are not going to be doing it correctly, Nothing to say. I leave it the rest to your imagination.
I don't think we'll have to imagine. Over the past 1.5 years, we have seen good trainers click and bad trainers, we know, rather we don't know where they are. So,
you know, Mr. Vaidyeswaran, I would like to say something here.
Yes, sir.
Before the COVID, if there were 1 lakh trainers, after the COVID, there is zero. Because all the 1 lakh were offline classroom trainers. And online is an entirely different ballgame altogether.
Absolutely.
It is like reading a book on swimming and getting into water. If you have done a course on speed reading, maybe you can complete the book in 1 hour, get into the water, you will drown in 1 minute. So you see, it's an entirely different ballgame altogether. But I can tell you one thing. Online training can be extremely satisfying.
Yes.
Because you see, you will have to work through your cognitive abilities to design a good training program. You have to understand the strategies of how to drive implicit learning, because implicit learning is what you really do on an online platform. You don't do anything else. The video is muted. What I'm not yours, I'm telling everybody's view, most people's video is muted. You don't even know whether they are there behind the screen or not. You're talking to a wall. You're not talking to a person. And as far as I remember, it was only Prahlad who could talk to a wall and get Hiranyakashyap out. No one has been able to do that after that. So you see, we are trying to do the next to impossible.
No, I think to add to what you're saying, talking to a wall, and it is really up to the trainer whether they bring out Narasimha or Mahavishnu. So I mean, so thanks a lot for your time, sir. I think I'm really looking forward to your program, which is going to happen on the 25th, because I think today you've given only a sliver of what is about to come on the 25th morning at 11. So
it's a free program. Please mention that it's a free program. It's a 3-hour master workshop.
Absolutely.
This is to help the trainers. You know, I would like to share with them some of the techniques which I adopt in my training, which has made me so successful and which has made, which has satisfied so many participants who have come. Yeah. And incidentally, Mr. Vaidyeswaran, you know, if your questions are over, if anyone has got any questions from the audience, maybe we can take that also.
Yes.
They have been a very disciplined audience, and I think we need to reward them for that.
Absolutely. So we've got a fantastic audience today. And yes, I would like to open the floor for questions. If you have any questions, you can post them on the chat window, or I'm going to turn off. I'm going to allow you to unmute. So if you want to unmute, you can ask your questions in that mode as well.
Sir, good evening. This is Gopi Krishna. Can I ask you a question?
Please do, Mr. Gopi Krishna.
Sir, how we evaluate our programs, online programs? Efficacy.
You know, we are, you know, I'll tell you, this evaluate term is a very common term which is used on the offline platform. For everything we want to evaluate. We are talking on the online platform about seeding. Mr. Gopi Krishna, is this the first program you have come to of mine?
Yes, sir. I have been listening to you quite some time, sir.
You have got the answer now?
Yeah, true. Yeah, because...
Now, what evaluation do I need to do? You put a grain of sugar and the ants keep coming, the grain sugar is sweet. If it is a salt, the color is the same. The ants will not come in.
Sir, I am asking about the efficacy of the program. After program, how do we evaluate? That's my question.
How much you desire to learn? Evaluation can be done in a corporate setting. Supposing you are doing a training in a corporate setting. Can you focus on Mr. Gopikrishnan, please?
Mr. Durga Prasad, can I'll bring.
Can you please focus on Mr. Gopikrishnan?
Yes.
I'm doing that.
Yeah, please.
He's also muted.
Yeah.
Mr. Gopikrishnan, can you please unmute your video so that I can see you?
I don't think there is a response from him. Mr. Gopikrishnan, are you there?
Yeah, I'm unable to unmute. Yeah.
Okay. You're unable to unmute your video. Fine.
Yeah.
You see, Mr. Gopikrishnan, in a corporate setting, definitely a needs analysis would have been done before the training is given, the training assignment is given to a trainer.
Yes.
Am I right or wrong?
100%. Right.
Okay. So now after that, there is a time, you know, there is a time period for which the person will be observed. All those people who have undergone the training, they will be observed, and their, you know, how they are improving will be measured.
Yeah.
That will tell you what sort of an impact has been there, because see, in a corporate setting, okay, mostly the training is technical in nature.
True.
Aspirational trainings are not done in a corporate environment, other than maybe motivational trainings, unless, you know, the company has got certain rules that this many hours of training has to be done, and, you know, they do it. Otherwise, you know, most trainings are technical in nature. How well the person is able to perform after the training has been undergone by the person will tell you what level of improvement is there in him.
Okay.
In the case of non-corporate training, where aspirational trainings are done, the appearance of the person again for the next training will tell you whether the impact has been there or not, because none of the trainings are free.
Okay.
Even if the person does not charge money for that training,
okay,
you are giving 3 hours of your time, which is the most precious thing for you.
Yeah.
Will you give that if you are not going to benefit anything?
I agree with you, sir, but my apprehension
there
is that...
There is no but. For everything, there can be a but. Either you agree or you disagree.
Disagree to some certain extent. Why
okay,
I'm telling
thank
that,
you. That's
sir,
okay.
You, telling,
are,
sir?
You are entitled to disagree with me. There is absolutely no compulsion that you need to agree with me.
Okay.
This is my answer.
That's fine.
You asked a question, I gave an answer. I am not open to continuing a discussion and argument.
No argument, sir. It's only... absolutely.
You see, this can continue eternally.
No, I'm getting knowledge from you. It's no argument.
If you are getting knowledge...
My only question is...
Evaluation is good.
My only apprehension is, because this is a... expectations from the corporate, as you rightly put in. So how do we meet? That's my apprehension.
It's very simple. I said, see, the moment the training is over, my dear Mr. Venukrishnan, you get married, you got to wait for 9 months for the child to come.
True.
You can't say, I want the child immediately. So you see, the training the corporate gives, they have a time plan. They will have a way in which they will assess what the improvements are.
Okay.
You see, there will be a capability mapping before and after.
True.
And through that capability mapping, they will find out whether there has been impact of the training or not. You're talking about technical training. But in an aspirational training, when the person develops a desire to learn more. So today, for instance, I spoke about reality mapping.
Okay.
I'm sure most members who have heard it will now go to Google and Google and see what is reality mapping.
Yeah.
I spoke about implicit learning. Yeah. I spoke about dynamic system control. Now, I'm sure most of you will go back and Google and see what is dynamic system control. That says sure. I have been successful in seeding your mind.
Okay. That's a.
So you have asked a question. You have asked a question, right?
Yeah.
That says I have been successful in generating a desire in you to know more.
True, sir. True. True.
This is what is the way you evaluate.
Okay. Creating a urge to dwell more.
That is what is seeding, isn't it? You can't take the can take the horse to water. If it doesn't want to drink, what do? Drink yourself or what? you see, you can only then, like the other day, Mr. Pattabhiraman in one of the programs was telling, you keep taking the horse around the pond 10 times till it becomes thirsty.
Okay. true.
In lighter mode, who has got so much of time?
True, sir. Thank you.
Yeah.
Mr. Venukrishnan has raised his hand.
Yes, Mr. Yeah, Venukrishnan.
Can I speak?
Yes, please.
Yes, please. Mr. Venukrishnan.
Yes, Mr. Venukrishnan. Tell me.
Yeah. My name is Venu from Muscat, Oman.
Nice to have you on the platform, Mr. Venu.
Thank you very much. In fact, I had seen your introduction during one of the programs recently, and then I got interested in the topic which you are doing. My question is, implicit learning also, does it also cover linguistic barriers?
Obviously.
See, the
have
reason
you heard about Stephen Krashen?
No, I haven't.
Googled.
Okay.
Mamaji is always available. Stephen Krashen.
He is
a professor of linguistics in California University.
Okay.
And he was the one who gave the SLA theory, secondary linguistic acquisition theory.
Okay.
He's a master in languages.
Okay.
You see, language itself is an implicitly learned trait.
Okay.
Otherwise, why would you know one language and why would I know another?
Yeah.
Why would a Bengali person know Bengali language and a Tamilian know Tamil language? A Hungarian know Hungarian and a Russian know Russian? Isn't that implicit learning?
Yeah, but see, the question why I'm asking you this question is now I am in a Gulf country. Most of the time I face audiences who are Arabic speaking or maybe bilingual, or they are more comfortable in Arabic than English, but then I am restricted to English. So when I deliver a training program, the challenge what I face is that I am not 100% sure what I am delivering. Is it reaching into their brains? And the same way, what they ask me, whether it gets connected to me. Does implicit learning handle or take care of those linguistic barriers? I don't know. It may be a similar thing may be happening in India also. You may be having a North Indian who doesn't speak English properly, but he's very comfortable in Hindi, sitting in a program where it is only conducted in English. So this again becomes a linguistic barrier.
It can cross linguistic barriers.
Okay.
Through observational techniques, like Mr. Vaidishwaran was saying, but in the absence of language parity, you are going to find it extremely difficult to drive it, because language is the foundation of all communication.
Exactly. Yeah.
Okay, so let me not try to fool you by telling that implicit learning, because this itself proves the rule, because I'm telling you, language, you learn the language by the age of 5.
Yes.
By the age of 5, if you are exposed to multiple linguistic environment, you learn all the languages. Like, I was born in Calcutta, brought up there. I grew up learning Tamil, Hindi, Bengali, and English. A person who is born in Andhra Pradesh, a Marathi person born in Andhra Pradesh, living in a society which is predominantly of North Indians, will grow up learning Telugu, Hindi, Marathi and English.
Yes.
But then at this age, if you try to learn, it'll be very difficult because now what you are doing, understand the difference. Now you are going in for explicit learning.
Okay.
That is the reason why you find it difficult.
Okay.
You understand what I mean?
Yeah, I understood. So basically, I'm not again, maybe possibility is that still I may not be able to break the barrier 100% because there is a language, it is a problem with the understanding due to the language differences.
You see, it is something like this. If you know the strategies of how to drive implicit learning, because there are plenty strategies, not one. There are many strategies. What you can do is maybe design a program which will help you to adopt your requirement to one of the strategies where the dependence on language is less.
Okay.
Or where you can translate a portion of it which will align itself with the strategy.
Okay.
And then drive it.
Okay. See,
because you see, all that you need to do, Mr. Venukrishnan, in your training is seed the desire to learn in the individual.
I am a subject matter expert, so I'm not a soft skill trainer. So for me, the kind of advantage is people come to learn subjects. So it becomes easier
Let me ask you a simple question. You are a subject matter expert.
Yes.
So you are at 100 out of 100. Correct?
No,
what are the subjectives? Let us assume you are at 100 out of 100.
Yeah, you
people
can assume.
People come to you to learn. I'm telling this, you understand.
Yes.
People come to you to learn. But people who come to you to learn will be at 60, not at zero.
Yes, correct. Exactly.
Now this 60, if you put the desire in them to reach the 100, you have done your job. They will go and find out the balance 40. How did you find the 100?
Okay, understood.
The same route they will take. You understand what I mean? A subject matter expert is also like a grain of sugar, which will attract ants interested in becoming SME in that subject.
Yeah.
They will have a foundational expertise in it.
Understood.
One of the mistakes that the subject matter expert, sorry to say this, please don't mind. It is it's not a reflection on anybody. But one of the mistakes the subject matter expert does is he thinks he has to translate his expertise to them. No, he has to seed them with the desire to become an expert like him. He has to become a role model, not a translator.
You can't transfer
your knowledge to them because your knowledge was arrived at with capabilities which are unique to you.
Yes.
Capabilities and experiences that are unique.
They're unique to you.
Yes.
You know, like they said, if God had wanted two Albert Einstein, he would have made two of them. He made only one.
Yes.
The other he made was an Edison or a Newton.
Yes, yes.
So, God in his pristine wisdom has made one Venukrishnan and let that one shine like a star in the sky and be the pole star which shows the direction. Others let them follow with their own capabilities and I'll reach you. That is what as a trainer we should all try to do.
I think that's a very good message you've said, sir, because implicit learning for all it is actually a very personal experience. So you are able to generate those, if you are employing implicit learning techniques, you are able to generate those aha moments in your audience. And once you do that, that will make your learning stick and that will help them discover their own path. So as a subject matter expert, you will be showing them the path rather than the knowledge.
Let people want to become like you.
Exactly.
You know, people should want to excel. They should want to cross you, overtake you. You see, I'll tell you like Steve Jobs said, he said that I always try to select people who have got the potential to become better than me. Because if I take people who are lesser than me, I will be a company of pygmies. If I take people who are bigger than me, I'll become a company of giants.
Yes.
My objective should be that every individual who attends my program should excel and be better than me.
Yes.
That is what is transformation. Transcending current formation. If I cannot help a person transcend his current formation and excel me, I'm a failure as a trainer.
So I'm looking forward to your program on 25th.
Sir, you are most welcome. It will be a pleasure and an honor to have a person like you grace the occasion. A personal invitation from me has gone to you right now.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
In extension of Venu Krishna.
Language barrier. Though.
Language barrier.
This language barrier.
This is Pat. I'm Piraman raising this doubt. Can the host enable my video?
I'm language barrier.
I'm Pat, from. You can start your video. North just India. Start your video.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'll spotlight. Yeah.
No, in extension.
Mantuji, you can go next.
Okay.
In extension of Velu's, the language barrier, he said, my doubt is that the circumstantial force nourishes or forces a person.
Please tell me in simple words. I'm unable to understand such complex language. No. Just tell me in very simple words.
Force of circumstances.
What is the circumstances you're talking about?
No, I'll give an example. The question is, a force of circumstances will cause implicit learning. For example, at Mahabalipuram, we have this, you know, uneducated or illiterate people speaking many languages. Do they get it by implicit learning?
Obviously.
Oh, yes.
They are not going to any, I understand, these tourist people, tourist guides.
Right.
Yes.
They speak many languages. They don't go and attend any class.
Languages, yeah.
They don't. By force of circumstances, by interacting with them, they are by observation, what Mr. Vaidhi was talking about, observational learning, they learn. That is how all of us have learned all languages. Only thing is, if it is at a very young age, the learning is more profound than at an elder age. Because as you grow, your dependence on explicit learning to suppose something grows. So it is less fast in learning. Implicit learning is very fast and you're not conscious of it. Implicit learning is when you learn without being conscious of the process and it is very, very deeply ingrained. Not only in Mahabalipuram, you go to any tourist center.
Yeah, obviously.
You will find that the guides can speak multiple languages.
A lot of foreign languages.
You go to Varanasi, the ghats, you will find the pandits speak literally every language of this country because everybody goes there for the antim kriya of their elders. This is all through implicit learning. They don't go and attend any class on languages. They don't go and attend any grammar classes. And you will find a lot of it will be broken languages, but they communicate very well. It's all implicit learning.
Excuse me to continue on that, Mr. Arun. That means implicit learning. I will start my video later. So implicit learning is difficult as you go ahead in life? I mean, no. Is that what you are
saying? No.
No, not at all. Implicit learning is not difficult as you go ahead in life. For instance, people who go to the office, go to the office at the age of 26 and 27. But very soon they realize and understand the nuances of office life, how to navigate office politics. Some people become extremely good at it and they rise only based upon their ability to navigate the office politics rather than their ability to do the job and get results. How do they do that? That is through implicit learning. They understand by seeing the circumstances without their realizing they understand how they have to behave at what time. For instance, a lady gets married. A young girl of 20. She gets married, comes to her in-law's house. Initially, she will be very subdued. Even the maid servant will come and tell her, this is not how things are done. Give her 2 years' time. She will tell everyone how things should be done. What is this if not implicit learning? How did she learn to control the entire house? How did she learn to control her husband, her in-laws, everybody in the house? Implicit learning. Nobody gave her a book and said, this is how you have to govern the house. Implicit learning is all around us, Mr. Daniel. I think it was Mr. Daniel who asked the question.
Yes, yeah, absolutely. Yeah.
Implicit learning is all around us. When you put your conscious mind to something to learn, you have moved away from implicit learning into explicit learning. And then you will start struggling. Explicit learning is difficult. That is the reason, you know, why schools struggle. Because they drive education through explicit learning. Now, pandemic has forced them to adopt implicit learning. Now you will find when the teachers start adopting implicit learning techniques and apply it on students, you will find the real brilliance of human mind come out. In fact, I always say this COVID pandemic is a blessing in disguise. It's a watershed moment in the evolution of man. Now man's brain will really show what it is capable of.
Absolutely. I think we have reached the top of the hour. We are actually past the top of the hour. So if you have any further questions, please leave us a message. And thanks a lot, Mr. Arun, for joining us today on this podcast. And of course, once again, I would like to reiterate that we have Mr. Arun's program on the 25th of July at 11 in the morning. It's going to be a 3-hour program. So please join in. So I'll be there. So please join me.
Can we have the video, Mr. Durga Prasad, of that program?
Sure, I'll play it.
Yes.
Now.
Please. So let's look at that video. Absolutely.
In 1971, the United States government banned tobacco ads from television and radio. It was a culmination of a process which started in 1964 with the Fairness Doctrine of the US Federal Communications Commission. You cannot be blamed for thinking that this incident, spanning a period of 8 years, was preparing you for the changes that would happen due to the pandemic. You must be wondering what the pandemic has to do with all this. Let me explain. Ever since the pandemic has hit us, one particular phrase has been in extensive usage, both in academic circles and the corporate world. That phrase, my dear friends, is implicit learning. It has engulfed the world of commerce and education because of the compulsion to train and teach online. So what is implicit learning? What has implicit learning got to do with the community of inquiry as propounded by Pierce and Dewey, which in 2001 got modified further by Garrison, Anderson and Archer? How is implicit learning aligned with the various stages of the taxonomy of cognitive learning? Why is implicit learning so important for the online platform? On 25th of July, in my free online workshop titled The Science and Strategy of Implicit Learning, we will discuss these and many more questions. We are going to discuss this through the case study of the tobacco industry and see just one of the various strategies of driving implicit learning. Come friends, this is a golden opportunity for you to design a program and drive it through implicit learning in that workshop. How do you do it and how do you embed the message, the insights in the subconscious mind is what we are going to see on the 25th in that free master workshop. If you are a trainer, if you are a teacher, or if you are a person aspiring to become a trainer, a master trainer, please do not lose this opportunity to attend this masterclass. Remember, 25th of July, 11 a.m. for 3 hours, the masterclass on the science and strategy of implicit learning. One more thing, my dear friends, the seats are limited.
So immediately click on the link below and register for the workshop so that we can send you the link to join on the 25th of July at 11 a.m. The masterclass, The Science and Strategy of Implicit Learning. Thank you.
Thanks a lot for sharing that, Mr. Durga Prasad. So once again, please make sure that you are there on the 25th. Join me as we will spend 3 hours together to learn from Mr. Arun on his strategy of implicit learning. So once again, sir, thanks a lot for your time this evening to talk to me on the Empathic Designer podcast. And thanks a lot for a wonderful live audience that we've had over here. So as usual, this recording will be made available on my podcast either later tonight or tomorrow morning. So make sure that I've posted the link to the podcast, as well as you have the link to the 25th event in the chat window. So make sure that you check out both. And as always, if you have any questions or any comments that you would like to share, please feel free to drop me a message, and I'd be very happy to take your questions and have a conversation with you. So thanks a lot once again, and have a wonderful Sunday evening. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you.